get my damn handkerchief right, honey. Ooh. Fabulous. Well, I don't know why I'm sitting here watching the rain. Right during the scary part. There's Kathy. Hey, Kathy. Hey, hey. And Sylvia. Y'all. I'm gonna finish this bag of chips while I wait for some people to arrive. Because I'm gonna share with y'all a little story. And you ain't gonna believe this shit. So, we have approximately 18 chips until I begin. Hey, Tracy, Sylvia, Danita, Carolyn, Michelle. Hey, Michelle, Pia, Sharon, girl, you ain't gonna believe it. Melissa, LaRonda, one more second, I'm almost ready to begin. Michelle, I'm checking. Rahelia, Juan, I hope y'all are here. Yes, Sylvia, you ain't gonna believe this shit. Hey, Peyton. So, Jen, what's up, girl? What's up, Tauru? They're the best chips ever. Pam. Okay. I know y'all been waiting all day. I've been bitching all day long. But listen, honey, I've come to a conclusion. But we're gonna get to that. So, kind of Pam. The drink of the day is, I ain't gonna tell you what brand because they don't send me no damn checks. So they can kiss my fat ass. But it's this thing, it's a stir-in iced coffee. So, look. Candy, girl, listen. You telling the truth. Look, I got me a cup of cold milk. I got this here no-name brand iced coffee, caramel macchiato. Okay? I'm gonna see how this shit mixes with cold milk. And don't look, I mean, it kinda looks like baby puke. Hold on, I'm gonna stir this thing up, y'all, cause I'm gonna need to drink this. Raven the Polish is on point, ain't it, baby? Look, bam, bam, look at yourself. Whoop, whoop, you look good, you look good, you look good. Bam, one more time, all right, see? Every time I go around in a circle, am I making y'all dizzy? Listen, and don't be rushing me because I ain't gonna fuck up this coffee drink before. This is not gonna be children friendly, by the way, language wise. Now, there will be no nudity, but I'm probably gonna use some language before prime time hours, okay? Give me a second. I am mixing a no name, send me a check and I'll show you name brand. Version of stir-in coffee that you can get at your local Tar Schwat. Okay? That's good. Okay. So, y'all know I got a job working at a long-term care facility. I might need to turn off the ring. I'm watching The Ring, and I get distracted. I love a horror movie. Anyway, so I got a job at a long-term care facility as the activities coordinator. I was hired with no experience in the working, particularly in the industry, but I had an extensive amount of experience working on the education side of things. I worked for a company where I did online education for nurses, and I knew a lot about, like, like, you know, when you're watching a video about what you're supposed to be doing on your job, I was working for the company that made those videos, but they were online. You know what I'm saying? So I knew a lot about the educational side of it, but not the practical application side of it. So, you know, they had a few applicants. I go in, and on my day in, I'd left a note. I did. Y'all saw a couple of the things I had done to get attention. And then on the day of my interview, I came in with a bunch of glow bracelets. And we went around. I said, well, let me show you how I can make people smile with very simple things. So the administrator and me went around the whole facility, and I put glow bracelets on all the residents and the staff, and everyone was smiling and happy. And a few days later, they called me back. This is less than a month ago. Call me back and say, congratulations, you got the job. I was like, oh my God, thank y'all so much. I'm so excited. So I start the job, and they knew I wasn't certified. I'm not qualified. You know, I don't have no letters after my name. They knew all that stuff. They knew all my history. They'd done a background check. You know, they plucked out a couple of pubes and tested them for, I don't know, whatever. You know, pee in a cup, all that good stuff, you know? So they knew everything there was to know about me, honey, except for my biological father's name. Okay. I'll drink to that. So, I'm working this job, and I got this guy who is now the janitor, or I don't know, Mr. Fix-It. I don't know what his official title was. He just did everything around there. And he was formerly the activities director there. And he was like, he really liked to talk a lot about the things that he did a few years ago, and the things he did were great. But he left that role, and they had since had another activities director and another one, and then they didn't have anybody for like the last month or two, and then they finally hire me. And so he's training me on everything I'm supposed to be doing, right? And so he's basically like, you know, you once you do your technical stuff, like your, like when you get a new admit, you know, your one-on-one assessments of somebody new coming into the facility, you know, he's like, these are things you do, blah, blah, blah. So I'm doing everything he's telling me to do. So I was trying to be proactive. It was like my first day. They kind of set me loose on the job, right? So I'm sitting there that day, and in the morning meeting, they had mentioned that one of the residents was really down. And somebody said that, you know, the last activities director, like a couple of months ago now, used to do a lot with her because she was in a wheelchair and she was really down. And so I said, well, what's her name? What's her room number? Took her name down. Down a room number, and you know, I'm thinking, you know, well, this is a great opportunity for me to, you know, help her. So I talk to her, I tell her, come on down to my office anytime, I'm gonna set up an easel for you. They had, Chris actually had set up this thing, you know, like one of the activities directors a couple of times back had set up this like paint easel thing. I don't know what you call it. What do you call it? Is it an easel? Easel. It's spelled weird, I know that. So, it's to where you can wheel it right up to the wheelchair, and she can paint, and it was beautiful. And so I got that, you know, blew the dust off of that thing, got it all set up, and set up this big giant picture of a velvet horse in the sunset, and it was on, again, it was like, you paint it, and then it had velvet and stuff. It was gorgeous, y'all. And she was painting that thing, and she was painting it psychedelic colors. And every once in a while, I'd have to do is just hand her a new fresh paintbrush, and she'd tell me what color she wanted, and I'd set up the color, and I had it on top of a box sitting in a chair so it was at level so she could reach over and dip the paintbrush in, right? So she's doing that, and then another one of the residents came down and wanted me to touch up her nails, so I'm sitting there doing her nails. And at that point, the administrator had walked in and wanted to talk to me about something yesterday. And she just walks into my office. First time she'd ever walked into my office. And she's like, hey, just wanted to check, you know, see what was going on. I never get down to this end, wanted to come say hello. I said, yeah. And I'm literally sitting on the floor, painting one of the residents' fingernails. And while one of the other residents who has not been leaving her room as much as she used to and was expressing, you know, sad things, sad thoughts in the morning to her nurse, I'm sitting there trying to reach out to her, and she's painting, and she's already working on her second picture, and it was beautiful. I had one out to dry, and I promised her, I said, I'm gonna hang this out in the hallway for you. And she was so excited. She goes, you promise you'll hang it out there? I was like, I promise. I said, I can't promise how long they're gonna let me leave it out there, but I'm gonna hang it in the hallway. And me, you know, and this is what's all going on. This is all yesterday, by the way. So everything I had done at that point, I had done one-on-ones with people. And what I had done with the one-on-one assessments for new people that came in, or for people that, one-on-one interactions for people that I found out who the room-bound people were. The folks had not been leaving their rooms. So I went into the system and I found out what their birth dates were. And I calculated their birth dates and I figured out, I was like, okay, when they were about 18 or 19 years old, it would have been music of the mid-60s. And so then I would go and create these playlists of music, like four or five songs that were popular when they were like between the ages of like 16 and 20. And these are people that are like typically unresponsive, okay? So that was like, that's one of the things that I had already done. I did that on my very first day, which was like 3 days ago, like let loose on my own. So y'all follow me, I'm doing everything I can. And so meanwhile, all of the technical stuff is being shown to me by my direct supervisor, who is formerly a activities director. And now does all of the maintenance and stuff for the building. And so he was showing me everything that I was supposed to be doing in the computer. And meanwhile, he's having these little sidebar comments about the administrator saying things like, that girl is, what did he said, that girl doesn't know what the fuck she's doing. Sometimes he says that. Sometimes she says things, and she used to have these meetings when, you know, she would force us to end the meetings in prayer. And I was like, I finally stood up and said something to her about it. And he's like giving me all the, telling me all this stuff about her. And I'm like, and I said, when you said that girl, I said, listen, I said, you probably should never say that again. And I said, especially in the earshot of a woman. And he kind of looked at me like, he kind of looked at me a little sideways, like, okay. But you know, I don't do locker room talk, honey. There's no reason why you couldn't refer to that person as the administrator. But talk about that girl. And he always would say her and she. He would never say her name or her title. It just bothered me. I was like, it's just so disrespectful, you know? But I was like, you know, also realized that I have to have a certain amount. I'm not very machismo. I don't have that competitive kind of, I have the protective instinct, but I don't compete with other dudes because I'm not a macho kind of guy. So I don't compete with macho kind of guys because what's important to them is totally not important to me. So it's just not even a point. You know what I mean? So I was like, you know, I'm just going to let him be who he is, you know, honey, whatever. I'm just going to keep being nice to him. And, you know, eventually at one point he asked me if I was married and I was like, no, he didn't ask me if I was married. I showed him a picture of, you know, I told him, I said, you know, I love to like perform and like be silly and stuff. I said, well, look, and I showed him a picture from my Facebook profile, the one of me in the mermaid tail. And he goes, cool. And so later in the conversation, he's like, so did you do that at Legends, the gay club? And I was like, nope, actually I did it at King's. It was like a bowling place. I said, but I would do it at Legends if they paid me. I'd do it anywhere. And I could tell that he was trying to figure out, you know, because I have painted nails. Dudes always try to figure out. They want to know, you know, is Lee a fucking queer? I've been through that conversation 100 times. So I made it pretty quickly. I brought up my wife and my daughter. And it still doesn't usually help because they just still can't figure me out. So I don't even get into it, all of it. I just let them come up with whatever story they want to have in their head, whatever makes them comfortable so they can continue on with the training. You understand? Shit. So, and it was like, everything I said I wanted to do, like, proactively in the job, he was like, well, yeah, but you have to make sure that you complete this and this and this. And I realized very quickly that he had everything set up to where he was constantly doing busy work. And I was thinking, and I'm looking at everything like, okay, well, this doesn't make any sense. There's easier ways to do this. You can do this quicker. And I think he quickly saw that I was like not a complete idiot. You know, I wasn't just this prissy man that had just floated into the building, that I actually had some knowledge, okay? So while we're doing this stuff in the system, he's showing me that, he said, so when you're rating somebody who's like a new admit, and this is all stuff I can tell you because there's nothing they can do to go back and change this. And this is the facts. This is what's in the system, the MDS system. And they were going, he was going in and saying that when you're rating somebody and the initial assessments on a scale of 1 to 9, you're asking them questions like, you know, what is important to you? Is bathing yourself important to you? Is having taking care of your own personal belongings important to you? Where does that rate on a scale? Is it important, not important? And he was telling me, you know, never rate it above a 3 on the scale. And I was like, well, why not? He goes, it triggers this thing. I don't remember the acronym he used. It goes, it triggers this thing called like an AAC or something like that. I don't know the shit. Like an AAC or something. And then he goes, you don't want that. And I was like, why not? He goes, because it go all down the line. It makes everybody else have to like do more work, basically, is what he's telling me. And I'm thinking, okay, so basically what you're telling me is this, if I do this, then it's going to make everyone have more tasks involved with the care plan. And ultimately, it would take more time. And you're telling me that they're basically not reimbursing the facility enough for that time. So we should just keep things at a minimum unless it's off the charts. And I'm like, I'm thinking, you know, that's like Medicare fraud. And I'm sitting there thinking, this ain't right. And I said, really? I said, what if it's that bad? He goes, if you can all at all not do that, that's fine. And I'm like, okay, here you go, Nicole, this is for you, honey. It's this polish is everything indeed, just so you know. I'll get you the brand in a second. So I'm sitting there thinking, you know, I remember the training on this, like this is like Medicare fraud. Why did you draw that? And I mean, and I have my notes from the conversation where it says never rate above a 3, and this is a little side note, and he says put an asterisk by that. I'm like, okay. So I put an asterisk by that. So,
he talks to you?
Thanks. I just have the front door open. Can you see the front door? It's the sun setting. It's the best time of day, y'all. It's the sunset. Thank you, Betty, by the way. So, you know, and so then there's this whole issue about, like, the mail. Okay, so like the mail, like he's always spouting off these random regulations that he has memorized. And he had this one about the mail, and when my first day, he goes, now this is the mail. This hasn't been done in like 3 or 4 days. So you need to get to this today. And I'm like, okay, how do I do it? He said, you have to go through the mail, look at the resident, look them up off the daily census list, find out what the room number is and deliver it. And I said, okay. So this is the day of the elections that I'm doing this. So the first thing I did is go through that mail and I took out all the personal letters. Anything from insurance companies, all that stuff, and I addressed it. Now, anything that was like duplicate political ads, because there was like 5 of the same political ad going to the same person, I was like, I would take out 4 of them and just gave them the one. Put them to the side. Didn't throw them away, put them to the side. And then there was a couple of things that came in. It was like the same phone advertisements. And I put one to the side and I put one and I delivered one. And so when the guy who's training me comes in, I say, so these are all like duplicates, and then there's political ads that are like duplicates. I was like, it seems ridiculous to deliver these same ones over and over, okay? And I said, what do I do with these? I said, do I still deliver them? And he says, well, technically per the regulation, da 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 da. He goes, but he says, you know, it's at your discretion. He goes, I said, well, what would you do? I said, I don't mind delivering it. I said, I just feel silly delivering the same ad for Pat McCrory to the same person, a stack of 5 of them, the exact same one. I made 4 of them. And he's like, what's your discretion? I was like, well, I'll probably just take it. He goes, if you have time. And I was like, I said, well, would you? He goes, but gee, you can just toss them. And I was like, okay. So I put them down into the little bin. And then the next day, the mail comes, and my assistant says, I'm going to do the mail for you. And I was like, okay. She says, I can sort it out by room. I know everyone by name. I don't even need to write anything on there. I'll do that. And so there was some like junk mail and stuff. And I was like, and I picked that up. And I was like, well, I said, what do we do with that? And she's like, well, she goes, I would just throw it away. And I was like, okay. Took and threw it in the trash can. Didn't think anything else of it. Okay. So fast forward to yesterday. And I'm in the office, and he had let me borrow. Do y'all following me so far? Give me some hearts and thumbs up if you're following the story so far. I feel like I'm jumping around. But anyway, I'm just kind of giving you some background. That I mean, I'm like learning the job, doing the job, doing the best I can, and I'm following everyone else's lead. I'm saying, what would you do? I don't know what to do. I was like, but I feel like I don't want to look like an idiot delivering the same kind of mail to people and giving people junk mail who can't even see. I mean, I feel like it's kind of a cruel joke, you know? So, anyway, so fast forward to today, or yesterday, I'm going through this day, I'm having this awesome day, I'm having a couple of breakthroughs with people, I've done these one-on-ones with people, and then all of a sudden he's telling me I'm doing these one-on-one assessments wrong. He's like, you have to do both of these questionnaires. I said, well, both these questionnaires asked the same question. I was like, and they were asking me, when I was doing both these questionnaires, they're looking at me and asked me, why didn't you just ask me this question? And I was like, I did. I said, I have a sheet I need to fill out. And I said, Chris, I said, this is the same things, the same damn things. And he's like, but this is what was left for me, da 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 da. And so I'm going on the intranets looking up these forms. And while I'm on there, I just did a search for the name of this form. And there's a whole back part of the form that they're not even using. And he had a piecemealed version of this, the assessment put together, that was wrong. I'm telling you, it's wrong. And I'm looking at it and asking questions, and all of a sudden he starts getting all red and huffy with me, and he says, you know that long-term care book I let you borrow? I was like, yeah. I said, I actually started reading through it last night. He said, I'm gonna need you to bring that back. I said, okay. I said, but if I go home, I live 30 minutes from here. I said, it's gonna be at least an hour before I get back. And he's like, that's fine. He says, but I needed to enter this stuff into the MDS. And he's sitting at my computer typing, right? So I'm like, okay. So I get in my car, drive all the way back to Apex, fix myself a salami sandwich with nothing but a little mayonnaise on each side, put that bitch together, grab the book, get back in the car, drive all the way back to the other side of town. I've been gone like an hour and 15 minutes. And I walk in the door, I walk in, and when I get to my office, my door is not only open, it is propped open with a doorstop in it. And I was looking at the door, I'm like, why is my door open? Because I left the office with him in there typing. He said, go home and get my book, I need it, so I can put this in. All my notes are in there. And I was like, okay. So that's what I did. And then I come back, the door's open. So that's an important piece of information, because shortly after that, I get called up to the administrator's office. And she says, it's been brought to my attention a few things that are against regulation, and I want to talk about them with you. And I was like, okay, sure. And she said, I understand that you entered a couple of notes in the MDS system. I said, well, yeah. I said, because first thing this morning, I was told, make sure you do your new admits and enter in your quarterly notes. And so the way that he showed me to do it is to go in, he kept documents on the computer of old patients and notes from their file, and he was copying and pasting that, and then changing the name, and copying and pasting that into the MDS system. That's what he was doing. So, and he said, this is how I do it. There's a shortcut around it. Okay? So I went in there, and he told me to do this, so I'm thinking, and I remember he also said, don't ever go on this side of the system, but that was the day before. He trained me on it, and then the next morning, he's like, do this and do this, making it sound like I got to get to all this shit. And I'm like, it's 9 o'clock in the morning, I'm going to be able to get to all this. This is not a huge workload. In fact, I think I can get to more than this. And I'm like, it was just, everything was just very, this is very strange as I'm reliving it. So I'm sitting in her office, and she's pushing this stuff across the desk, saying, you know, there was this mail that was in the recycling bin. And I'm like, well, yeah. I said, I asked Chris about it, and he said, just go on and throw it away. He said it was at my discretion. I asked him what he would do, and he's like, just go ahead and toss it this time because of all the political stuff. And I was like, yeah, okay, that makes sense. And she said, well, this is someone's phone bill. And she slides across the thing, and I'm looking at it. I'm like, that is not a phone bill. That is a prepaid wireless company, honey. You don't get a phone bill from a prepaid wireless company. But anyway, I didn't say that, but that's what I'm thinking. And I'm like, okay, so maybe it accidentally was slipped in there. I didn't See, I don't remember putting that in there. I remember a stack of political ads. I remember I had two Peter Popoff ministry chain letters to the same person. They got one of them, and I kept the other one because it was the same thing. And that was it. And so she says, you know, this is a really big deal, and it's against federal regulations, and understand you entered something in the MDS, and the notes were incorrect. And I was like, I did everything according to how I was taught to do. And I was like, this mail, I said, I was told to put this mail in the trash. Okay? And she says, okay, well, the one-on-one assessments were not complete. And I said, well, I said, according to Chris, I said, but these one-on-one assessments, I don't know why I keep saying his name. Anyway, it's not his, it doesn't fucking matter, it's the truth. These one-on-one assessments, I was like, this is what, he never showed me how to do it. He just told me what to do, and I went in with the assistant for the first one, and she said, you know, we'll do them both. We'll both do one. You primarily ask the questions. I'll step in if I need to, and then we'll compare them and see if it's the same. And they're exactly the same, except for one where I just got a little crisscrossed in my mind, and I put the opposite part of the scale. You know, I got the scales mixed because I was, like, really into talking to the person. And, you know, I just glanced down, and you know how that happens. And I said, oh, you know what, though? I said, I do remember this. I said, that's not the number I meant to put. And she goes, yeah, so we're right on the money. So do you want to do the next two? I said, sure, no problem. And I said, well, these are the same questions. Do you think I need to ask these questions twice? She goes, I don't know why they have us asking the same questions twice. But if I was just go through them, the checklist. And I was like, okay. And I'm using the laminated piece of paper they gave me and said, this is what you use for assessments. Not the staple piece of paper of an old copy of something that's like, looks like it's 5 years old. I'm using the one that's a print off from the MDS system, right? So I'm doing it exactly like we did before. I'm filling it out and I'm thinking, you know, well, I can go into the second questionnaire and answer these questions based on what we're filling out here. And if I'm conversational, knowing that using the second questionnaire as a guidepost in my mind, I'm like, this is easy. It's just like a doctor talking to you. Then he goes and fills out your chart. I said, it's the same kind of thing. I was like, this is my job, you know? So I did the full assessments. I'm putting in the numbers. And again, this is the thing where I'm told never put anything above a 3. Because if I do, it's going to trigger these things. I still don't know what it means. I don't even know if it's the right acronym. ACA or AACs. It's going to trigger. And it's going to make everybody have to do a whole bunch more work. And I don't want to piss off all the nurses. And then Jenny will get on my ass. I'm like, okay. Whatever. I was like, it doesn't sit well with me. And I came home that night and was like, Teresa, this doesn't seem right. I said, I feel like it's Medicare fraud, but I got to look this up. And sure enough, it is. It's like you don't rate a patient is any more severe than they are or in their answers. So other people don't have to do work? What about the patient? What about the resident? Where's the beef? Okay, so anyway, I got off on another tangent, and so she's like, and you entered this stuff in MDS, and I'm like, I did exactly the way I was told to. She goes, well, here's the deal. She goes, you were going to be checking on getting your qualification as an activities director, and you haven't done that yet. I said, this is only my second week in the job. And she goes, well, when can you get in that course? I said, well, the courses have been going on for the last couple of months. They end on the 17th of November or 19th for most all of the programs, if not around the 19th, right before Thanksgiving. I said, they don't pick up again until January. And she goes, well, we're going to need you to get qualified. We needed you to be qualified before then. And I was like, you knew when you hired me that I wasn't qualified, didn't have the credentials. And we discussed that I would be going to get that as soon as possible. I said, you understand schools don't offer classes during December. It's called winter break. It's like you hired me. I just started 2 weeks ago. These classes are currently going on in session. And you are getting on to, or they're just telling me that basically what they're leading up to is this. Here's the bullshit. She goes, so we have a couple of options for you. And, you know, if you can find a way to get your qualification quicker, that would be great. But in the meantime, we're going to need, it's going to be less money, and we'll have to take you down to part-time. I'm like, I ain't even been there for 2 weeks yet. Like, I just got my fingerprint put in the system yesterday. We'll have to take you down to part-time. And I said, what? I said, okay. And she said, or, you know, we can go ahead and let you go. And I was like, and I sat there for a second and I went, huh. And I was like, I got all teared up because I started thinking about the residents. And I was like, just that day, I was like making promises to some of the residents about things that I was doing. One of them had come up to me and spent some time in my office. I'm going to try not to cry. And he's in a wheelchair. And there was this moment where he had asked me to help him get in the door. And he's real like, don't help me. But he only can literally move his head and his hand. And he asked me if I could help maneuver his straw around for him so he could get in the office. And he comes in and he's giving me ideas on what he wants to do the next month. And I told him I was going to make it a regular thing and we're going to start setting up appointments. And he starts asking me about my family. And it takes a long time to have a conversation with him because, do you remember how Christopher Reeve was? How he'd have to take that long breath and then he would talk. He's in the same type condition. But he's completely there mentally. And I always remember when I'm talking to him, I'm like, I'm talking to somebody who is operating with a brain that has the same capacity as mine, but he's trapped inside of this body that has some malfunctions. So, you know, the more I talk to him, the more I just would get patient and just have this, it's just beautiful. And he would start hanging out and he said, I hope that you're here for the next 10 years. And I'm like, I hope to be too, I really do. And so I'm just like, so attached, you know? And so anyway, I'm sitting there, I start crying because I'm like, well, I said, did these things that I've done something that could harm the residents? I said, the idea that I would harm, anything I could do would harm them. I mean, I couldn't even fathom it. I was like, how? Just throwing away some day-old political ads the day after an election and some duplicate junk mail add up to all this. And I'm like, well, the only way she got any of this information is if this dude who's training me, who used to be the superhero of the building, told her, brought it to her. And I'm like, is he crazy? Does he not remember the shit that he's told me? And how almost everything he does, he's told me, you're not supposed to do it this way. And it's like, aren't they sitting there looking at me thinking, he came in here not knowing how to do this shit. Where did he learn to do it wrong if he's doing it wrong? You think look, I don't have an MDS cheat sheet tattooed anywhere on my body. I don't know how to use the shit. I don't even have a login. I'm using his login. And I'm like looking at them like, how do you think that I did these things wrong? Like, oh, and then she asked me about internet. She goes, there were some unauthorized websites that you were on. And I was like what? What? When? I said, the only two websites that I've been to is I played streaming country music when I had her in here in the wheelchair painting in my office and I asked her what kind of music she wanted to listen to. She said, country western. So I played a streaming country music station for 2 minutes when I realized that you could hear it better on my phone and turned it off of that little tiny little computer that sits next to the screen. And I said, and the only other thing I was on was Facebook, and that was just so my friend Jennifer, who volunteered, that's how I got a volunteer, as I posted on Facebook from the office. Because all these people that are on the damn calendar when I got here aren't showing up. And the residents aren't getting any damn interaction. I mean, shit. That's why I was on Facebook. Jennifer, I think you're on here. And Jennifer did an amazing job, and they talked about her the whole next day. Three of those ladies came to me just to tell me how great she was. And that I could bring any of my friends in. And then she's telling me in this thing, she goes, and your volunteer, did she go through the application process? I said, application process? What are you talking about? She goes, all volunteers have to go who come in here have to fill out an application and go through the background check. And I'm like, but I know her. I was like, and I told blank, my supervisor, I said, I even text him. Look, it's on my phone. I text him and said, the kind friend of mine who is coming in today is Jennifer Kidd. And she has already been told that she is not, Jennifer, you can collaborate this. I said, she's already been told that the only thing we're allowed to do per safety and infection control regulations is no nail clipping. If they bring their own file, she can use that. Everyone has to be, fingernails have to be swabbed with an alcohol acetone based thing, which I'm provided in a basket for her. And I'm like, and so she's getting on to me that. She goes, and you know, we can't just let anybody in our building. I'm like, hold on, but I didn't. I said, how am I in trouble for this shit? Nobody told me this. I said, I volunteer all the time. I ain't never had to fill out no application. And I'm like, what the fuck is going on here? I'm like, this is some crap. I'm like, this is crazy. So she says, so, you know, the other option is that, you know, we can just go ahead and let you go. And I'm sitting there and I looked at her and I said, I should just go. I think I'm just gonna go. And she goes, but you can also, you know, you can do part-time or you can also volunteer. Hold on. Let me choke myself out because you're making me feel crazy. Are you serious? Am I sitting here hearing what I'm hearing? These residents who have not had any interaction for a very long time. Somebody who is in activities has not even been taking the time to do individual thoughtful notes about them in the NDS system, has been rating them lower than they might needed to have been rated. This person has been doing all this for an extended period of time. This is how he's teaching me to do it. And all of a sudden, you've somehow caught me doing something? Honey, I'm in training. I'm in training. This is my third day. My third day, honey. Third day. So I'm within my 90-day probationary period, honey. I don't even get paid for holidays. I don't get paid for Christmas. I don't get paid for Thanksgiving. I wouldn't got paid for New Year's. I volunteered to work on the weekends. I was supposed to work today. I even went to the damn business manager and found out how to give tours at the damn facility. Little rich, ratchet-ass place. Let me tell you something. When I went in there to get, let me tell you something, they fucked up, honey, because I'm from the side of the industry where I know I can walk around there based on them training modules that were drilled into my head for 4 years. I can walk around there and see ding, 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 ding conversations with the clinical caregivers where they're talking, identifying patients that are Medicare and not Medicare and the non-Medicare private pay. The money patients, they called them, got more care or quicker care or more attention. They would get things quicker because they'd say, well, their family's going to call if we don't. So, this is my advice to you. Oh, Georgie, but you know what? Here's my new path, honey. I've signed up for my courses. I start in January. I'll be taking a job as an assistant activity coordinator at another facility. And in February, I will be licensed to be a qualified activities director in the state of North Carolina, honey. So then, I'm going to get a full-time job in a facility as an activities director. That's going to pay me better, okay? Better conditions of the residents. In the meantime, the state of North Carolina is going to take care of where I was working before. The wheels are already in motion. I've spoken to the proper people. See, they don't understand. All the people that I know in this industry through the years are on the money side of it, honey. The business side, not the caregiving side. The money side. And those resources that I had lined up to use in their favor, I can also line up to use to shut your ass down. And I'm like, they really should not have done this, because I feel like that maybe the only reason that I was put in that position and treated this way is for the well-being of those residents, which is ultimately the only thing I care about. The only thing. The only thing. And from the very beginning, I was told every time I mentioned to this person who's training me, you know, I really care. And he goes, I know you care about the residents, but you're not going to be able to do a lot of stuff with them. You're going to have to depend on your volunteers, and you're going to have to be in here and really stay on top of this paperwork. And I'm like, there is no, you have created a sense of urgent pile of paperwork that does not exist. It's only because you can't think proactively and figure out ways to, like, use your volunteers and your time to do groups of things. And I mean, it was just in the activities office, he was telling me how he used to roller skate around wearing a pimp costume, playing music, making everyone happy and laughing. And in the closet, there's all these little pimp costumes and stuff just in bags. And it was like, everything was like, it's the former glory of years past. And it just piled and piled. And it's like, if there's so much pride, and if you have so much pride in this department and what it was, then why did you let me walk into an office that has not been cleaned in an entire year? I literally walked in to paperwork. It looks like somebody picked up their purse one day, walked out the door, and never came back. And they shut the door, and it was not open again until I went back in there. It was crazy. So they're telling me they want me to go part time. I'm like, I'm just gonna leave. I'm like, I don't drive. I don't know if they thought that I had more money than I actually did. I don't know what it was. I don't know if maybe they sensed that I was starting to ask questions or raise an eyebrow at certain things, like conversations with housekeeping on why one of the residents was wearing gloves, because her hands felt so dirty because her bathroom had not had soap in it. And housekeeping then informed everyone in the room in the meeting that there had not been soap for approximately 48 hours, and they proceeded to argue over who was supposed to order it. And I'm like, that's why when I was playing music for her roommate, that's why she's wearing gloves, because she didn't want to touch her food with her bare hands because she had not been able to wash her hands in 2 days. Okay. Did y'all hear that? That's the sound of crickets in heaven, honey. And they are chirping a song that says, why in the fuck did you let this guy go? Because he cared about your residence. And now he's gonna take you down. So here's my career track again, okay? Here's my new career track. I will be an assistant activities director. I'll have my certification by February. I'll take a full-time job as activities director. For 2 years, I'll be attending college in the evenings at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, online, and I'll get my bachelor's degree in public health, upon which point I will then take a job with the state of North Carolina as a surveyor for long-term care facilities. So I would like to thank you, sir and madam, at previous facilita, for giving me my purpose and for showing me everything that I don't want to be and don't want to do, but also everything that I do want to do. So I thank you for that, sir and madam. Okay. I love them hearts. Thank y'all. So, I was not willing to go back and do the job for fucking Bupkis, because they're thinking, he's too happy. He's having too much fun. I bet he would do this job for less money and he could do it in less time. You fucking crazy? This place smells like shit. McDonald's starts at 11:50. I'd rather clean their bathroom. Okay. Y'all, let me tell you how they trained me on my first day. See, this is all shit. You can't change your shit. If they are watching right now, they can't go back and fix the shit I'm talking about. The shit I'm not talking about is the shit they can fix right now. They don't even know that I know. Because I got eyes. Stephanie, honey, I'm just trying to get my damn certification in activities first. One step at a time, honey. Don't make me jump ahead of myself. I'll talk my fucking ass out of it, okay? Right now, I'm fueled by rage and wisdom, okay? Because I can't stop thinking about those residents. And think them. What's in motion right now is going to help the hell out of them. Constance, my boo, my precious Constance. Y'all, I'm telling you, it was only the voice of Constance in my head that kept me from lighting into that administrator's ass. Because I have to tell you, on a personal note, she is an amazing woman. She is a good soul. But up until yesterday, I thought she was a great leader until that conversation. And I just wanted to be like, are you fucking kidding me? You realize that what has happened with me is an indicator of a big, much bigger problem that goes way above my pay grade. You know that I walked in with no experience. I have no idea about the technical side about the job. And you are reprimanding me for these things. You think I just went to a website and looked up ways? Oh, I went to www.waystofuckupyourjob.com. That's where I went. Okay. Well, and also, Betty, on that note, Teresa said, made a good comment. She said, baby, that dude did not like you standing in his spotlight. And I'm like, well, I can't help that I'm 8 inches taller than him. That's Mother Nature. Blame Jesus for that, honey. But I mean, everywhere I go, I block people's spotlight, and most smart people know just to share it with me, honey. I'm not gonna keep it for long, but I do like it. I like to put on a nice show. But when the spotlight's off, I'm still pretty much fucking sane. Except my skin doesn't look as good, and my teeth aren't as white. But I'm still the same. Okay? I love you too, Kathy. Bye, baby. You like that site, Betty? www.howtofuckupyourjob.com. I went there and got all kinds of tips. Specifically, for a ratchet-ass long-term care facility. Now, I did like their human resources person. I thought that she was just a ball of Girl Scout and sassy. You know what I mean? She was like the librarian that just wanted to bust out into song. You could tell at any time. There was a part of her just wanted just to be like, yes! But she wouldn't dare because she was always so busy. I really liked her. I really liked everyone there. I even liked the administrator until she acted like a dumbass right in front of me. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. If by Monday morning, if you're watching this, I'm going to go ahead and say this. If by Monday morning you come to your senses and a sincere video apology is posted, it better happen before 8 a.m., okay? I got my email set up on automatic send. Okay? Just let me know. I told Teresa, I said, listen, I said, if I didn't have to deal with him and they let me come back and somebody started over with showing me the right way to do this shit, I would continue on my course to get certified. I would stay with them certified. They can't never talk to me about no hours again. They're going to need to give me a $2 an hour raise. Okay? I mean, I'm standing at the urinal the other day, looking at the wall of the way the booth is hanging off the wall. And the damn plate that goes up against the wall that holds up the thing. You need to go poo poo Bojangles. Hold on, my dog's got to go poo. The plate, the metal plate that's got the screw on it, y'all, up against the wall. It's literally about to fall off the wall, and it's got that green oxidation rust on it. You know what I'm talking about? That real nasty rust. It looked like somebody peed all the way up the wall. Like public school bathroom kind of rust. You know what I'm talking about? I'm looking, and the screws all pulled out of the wall. And I'm looking at this shit, and I'm like, this is not the urinal. This ain't the employee urinal. You know what I'm saying? This is the urinal that, like, if somebody comes in for a tour of the facility and goes, my type 2 diabetes is acting up today. I decided to eat a Snickers bar this morning. I'm going to need to take shit and pee in your bathroom. This is the one that you would escort them to before giving them a tour of the facility. And they ideally want these people who come in for tours to sign up because they are the big money. Because normally it's people that have insurance plans or private pay. You understand? So they want these people to have an impression. So imagine driving up in your Cadillac, some nice ass clothes, you got money, you about to put grandma in a retirement facility, somebody's making a great impression on you, you go to pee, you go and look, and the booth is falling off the wall. Not because of a screw, but because of oxidation, time and neglect. Rust spots around where you TT. That means that backsplash has been splashed on and not wiped. You understand? Granny, you're not staying here, honey. I love you. I give you life. I love you, Nicole. Go shopping. You trying to tell me to go shopping after I just walked out my job? Oh, you sent me a check. Is it in the mail? Bojangles, would you go poop? You've been farting in there for go poo poo. Go poo. My dog, he don't want to go poop. You've been there just a farting on me. Oh, he's going under the deck. Don't poop under the deck. Go to your spot. Boji, go to your spot. Boji, go to your spot. Get up there, you dumbass. Get up there. Boy. You should get up there on Poop Hill. You're always trying to poop under the deck. That's so nasty. Anyway. Stephanie, well, before I discovered that you're no longer going to marry my neighbor, Stephanie, I would have said, well, you can have him when you move in, but don't. Hold on, I'm watching the dog, because sometimes he likes to sneak down that hill. Here you go, watch him. I see you. Get up there and poop, boy. What the hell? Oh, that was my ring. We are currently watching nature take place. My dog's making a fecal. If you're here to see why I got fired, you're just gonna have to wait till I end the broadcast and hit upload. Did he get back with his ex? No, he's just a douchebag. But we're friendly. Hey, how you doing? Good to see you. Kinda like that. Look at that pretty sunset. See that? Isn't that pretty? As soon as this dog starts pooping, I'm gonna show y'all.
Do work, son, yeah! Do work! Dropping that deuce, dropping that deuce, dropping, drop, 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 dropping that deuce, dropping that deuce, dropping that deuce. What's that smell? My deuce.
That's so nasty. I can smell it. Oh, it's gray. You've been eating my pills, Bojangles. You know those are Skittles, right? Y'all,
he just up there doing work on that hill. You see him? He fell in a hole.
Oh, you know you watch. I'm not one of them pet owners that looks away. I stare right at it. Get it, baby. Do work, son. Don't be embarrassed. Yeah, pinch it. Pinch it. He's done.
Good boy. You're such a good one. You got a pep in that step. You better go.
All right. He is doing good. Y'all, he just gave birth to triplets. Light brown and gray triplets. Kind of alien looking, more gray. OJ, we're gonna up your iron intake, honey. Let me open this door. Look at Stephanie. She said, good boy. Stephanie said, good boy. That's how she said it. She got that deep Yankee voice. She said, good boy, Bojangles. Stephanie, it makes me feel better to make fun of you, okay? She doesn't. She actually has a very feminine voice, but she would have said, good boy, Bojangles. Oh, I did give him, you know what I've been giving him? I've been giving him those dentabones. Those ones for his breath. Because his breath smells like asshole, okay? And I could not handle going to work every day in a building that smelled like asshole. And then trying to love on my dog, give him some kisses, and it smells like asshole, okay? Listen, y'all, I'm done. I done told my story. I done said my piece, amen to God. God knows I tried. But 'tis my curse to be fabulous and intimidate others, okay? It's not my fault. And one day, you're gonna see me walk in your building and you're gonna say, oh my God, he's with the state. And I'm gonna say, hello! How are you? You are on my list.